This stream was wild. Let's get into the hand. It's a 200, 400, 800. Rob Young is in the straddle. Now, JRB, high stakes extraordinaire, raises up to $4,000, a 5x raise. Personally, I would have liked to go a little bit smaller, especially with a hand like 7-6 suited, where it really gets a lot of its value from having a large SPR. And what that means is stack to pot ratio. So it basically means how much of your stack is left behind compared to how big the pot is. And so a hand like 7-6 suited, it wants to see a flop for as cheap as possible in comparison to a hand like Ace-Queen, where you probably want to get more money in the middle because you're only ever really gonna hit a pair. That's like what you're really aiming for. These big high card hands, they do a lot better with smaller SPRs. So now we have Douglas Polk, next act, 3 bets the Jack 10 suited, pretty standard play, deep stacked in position. I would definitely do this at full frequency, 100% of the time. And Nick Airball calls on the button with pocket nines, completely fine. Someone could argue for a 4-bet, some could argue for a fold, but he doesn't strike me as the kind of player to fold. So calling seems completely reasonable. Now, Rob Young calls out the straddle with his King Queen of Hearts. I like this call, given how wide everyone else is gonna be, given how many hands they're gonna be playing, King Queen suit is gonna be doing pretty damn well. He just has to hope that JRB isn't gonna wake up with a monster when he's only raised it once under the gun. JRB has an easy call with a 7-6 of hearts, and we're gonna see a flop. The flop comes Ace 10-7 Rainbow with the Ace of Hearts, very relevant card when everyone's looking at their own backdoor flush draws. Pretty much everyone's whiffed. Doug Polk goes ahead and fires a third pot c-bet. Now, it is interesting that a lot of people just won't have any bluffs in this kind of situation. They might even take like the best candidates to bluff, like 8-9 of hearts, and still check that. But Doug, I think he understands these multi-way situations relatively well. You can start repping very strong on later streets. So even though it's very likely that one of your opponents has a hand like Ace Jack, Ace Queen, Ace 9 suited, Ace 5 suited, because everyone's playing pretty wide. Given that you're c-betting into 3 opponents, you block the 10 so they can't have Ace 10 in pocket 10s as much. And you've got the backdoor straight draw and the backdoor flush draw and 2-pair and trip outs. It's actually a very, very good hand to c-bet third pot and will get a lot of respect. Nick Airball makes a very disciplined fold and Rob Young is next to act. And he actually manages to call the flop. It is a little bit loose in my opinion. I definitely wouldn't do this. When Doug Polk is c-betting here, he's not gonna have too many bluffs and his bluffs will probably keep continuing when he's c-bet into 3 people. It's a little bit loose of a float for my liking, but he's got a lot of money, he's got a lot of heart. He can do what he wants with his money. Now, of course, there's no justice in the world. The universe laughs at people who play well, and the turn is the offsuit jack. Bingo thinks both of the players. Rob Young checks it over to Doug Polk, who actually makes a very good check back. Again, as much as I would love to trash some of Doug's plays, just playing this kind of perfectly at the moment. You don't want to be inflating the pot when, you know, Rob Young, he can have pocket sevens here. He can still have ace 10, especially ace 10 suited. He can have ace jack offsuit, ace jack suited. You never know how wide he's going to be. And you never know if he has got something like king queen suited. The pot control method here is very, very powerful. The other option, and it's very useful to know that there isn't a single good option when it comes to a lot of these different spots, post-flop especially. You could do a multiple variety of things and no solver, no human being in the world will ever be able to tell you what's perfect because it's so multivariate. You don't know what range they're going to be having. You don't know how they're going to be reacting versus different sizes. So it's always worth saying, okay, here's one option that I could do. Here's the arguments for it. And here's another option that I can do. Here's the arguments for that based on their range, my hand, my perceived range, and things like that. And so the other option is to go the line that's called bet, bet, check. So the idea would be bet flop, bet turn, check river, because Jack 10 in this situation is definitely not a 3-street hand. You're not gonna get paid off 3 streets very often by ace 5 or ace 9 or anything like that. So you actually want to be looking for 2 streets of value. And so the options are bet, check, bet, or bet, bet, check. Now, Doug decides to go for the bet, check, bet line, and let's see a river. The river comes in offsuit 3, and we see a very fascinating snap check from Robert Young. Now, if I'm in Doug's position here, I'm gonna be trying to read as much as I can into what that snap check means. So here's what I would think it means. The better the player, the more likely it is that that snap check is a value hand. The worse the player, the more likely that it is that snap check is a bluff. And the worse the player, the more likely it is that that snap check is a weak hand, more like a 1-pair kind of holding like ace 9. And the reason for that is that when somebody snap checks, it's indicating that they don't really have a decision. So a player that's thinking on level 1 will be like, well, I've got 1-pair, I don't really have a decision. A player that's thinking on the level above, or maybe a couple of levels above, is thinking, I want to represent that I don't have a decision. I want to represent that I've got an easy check on the river. So then my opponent will think that he can value bet quite thinly, meaning he can value bet even maybe something like ace king, and then I'll go for a check raise, I'll set the trap. So it's very interesting that Rob Young finds that snap check there. I will say that from a timing tell perspective, when somebody snap checks the river and they're a thinking player, and then they raise versus a bet, it's a lot more likely to be a value hand than it is to be a bluff, because it seems like they've cognizantly made that decision to snap check to make it seem like they're weak when they're actually strong. This is really getting to the nuances of timing tells, but when you're playing online poker, it's probably the most common note I would ever make on a player is their timing tells. So these things are very, very important to learn from. They're very, very important to take note of. I've probably made thousands of notes in my online poker career about timing tells. So really try and pay attention to what timings mean what in different situations. It's extremely nuanced. There's no science to it whatsoever, but there is some analysis, some kind of like mass data analysis that you could end up doing, so you could kind of quantify it. So anyway, enough on timing tells. Doug Polk has a very easy value bet here, so here's how I would be thinking about this value bet. What is my opponent's range, and what am I going to do about it? My opponent's range is very likely going to just be like ace x. It's just going to be a lot of ace nine, ace queen, maybe ace king, probably not ace king, ace eight, ace five suited, hands along these lines. So the next question is, what am I going to do about that? And when I have a value hand, I'm thinking, how much will those hands pay? You know, I'm not thinking about wanting to balance versus bluffs. I'm not thinking about any of those things. I'm thinking, how much will this hand pay? Because I'm in this situation right now. I'm not in a different situation where I have a bluff. I'm thinking in reality, this is the difference between me and a very game theory oriented player. I am a lot more in reality, in my humble opinion. And these people are often these kind of like fugazi fake lands where they're like, well, hypothetically, if I had a bluff here, I'd want to balance it. But don't worry about that. This situation ain't ever going to come up again on the ace 10, 7, jack 3 board against Rob Young with the bet check bet line. It's just never going to happen again in your life. Play it highest EV for your hand in this situation. God damn it.
Sorry to interrupt the hand analysis. I'm here with my family in Costa Rica. I'm just telling you quickly, in Epiphany Poker, the community, the poker world's never seen anything like it. Next week, we have 1 hour of hand analysis, poker analysis from Jungle Man himself. The Discord is free to join. There are hundreds of people using it. There is hand history review on a daily basis. It's so important if you want to become a successful poker player, if you want to reach those high stakes, or you just want to crush your friends, to have a community of people around you that are supportive, that want you to succeed, aren't jealous when you crush. And this is what I've created. It is unlike anything else. You can check it out for free. Go to epiphanypoker.com. Join as a starter if you don't want to pay. I'll see you there. Peace. Enjoy the rest of the video. Say bye.
I think what I would end up betting here is something along the lines of $35,000. I want to make it small enough that he's gonna still be very tempted with his one pair holdings, but I want to make it big enough that it's not just gonna be like way too small. You know, there's a balance, you know, like if you bet 5,000, sure, you're gonna get called every single time by ace five, but if you bet 30,000, it only needs to work a sixth as often as the 5,000. And then you could argue for, okay, 60,000 only needs to work half as often as that. And that's kind of how you do these kind of calculations. Then on the other side of things, by betting small, you might induce some bluffs. Now, if I think that Rob Young's check on the river is going to be pretty weak, which on average I would assume that it is from a recreational player, and shout out to Rob for having the strong hand with the snap check, very, very sneaky, very deceptive. I would want to kind of bet on the smaller side, letting them know, hey man, if you want to turn your queen jack or your king 10 into a bluff here, be my guest, because I've got a capped range, you've got an uncapped range, let's do this thing. Doug Paul goes for the $50,000 bet. He's obviously thinking more in balance terms. What would my bluffs want to do here? What kind of, how many bluffs do I have compared to value hands? How does my range look against his range? That's his style of poker. You go to Upswing if you want to learn about that. But here on Epiphany Poker, we like to think in reality. Now, Rob Young gives Doug the bad news. He raises to 200,000, and you have to ask yourself, what are you going to do in this situation? It ain't easy. Is Rob Young going to be finding enough bluffs in this situation? Rob's good enough to know that we have a capped range, probably capped at two pair. I'm sure Doug could technically have something like king queen that he's checked back, or pocket aces that he's checked back, but I don't think in reality he actually would. People often think they're a lot more balanced than they are. So what would I do here? It's really tough to say. I would probably base all of my decision on reads. What do I think the snap check and then raise means? what do I think of the way that Rob's looking? Can I pick up any live tells? I would either call with 100% of my hands that have showdown value here, or I would fold 100% of my hands that have showdown value here. There's no in between for me, because Rob is either going to be way under bluffing or way over bluffing. And if you just break that down for a second, a lot of people will tell you, well, you have to just choose the best hands. It's actually not how game theory works. I'll give you the example. Let's say you're playing rock, paper, scissors. The game theory strategy, the balance strategy, the Nash equilibrium strategy is to be 33%, 33%, 33%. A third of rock, a third of paper, and a third of scissors. What happens if you know that your opponent is throwing 34% rock and then 32% of paper and 33% of scissors? What is your optimal strategy here? Now, a lot of people will say, well, you just throw a little bit more paper, but that's actually not true. Assuming that this person isn't gonna change their strategy, assuming that they're not going to adjust, which in poker is very often the case because the same situation isn't played over and over again, the optimal strategy is to throw 100% paper again and again and again and again and again, only if you know that they're not gonna adjust, which obviously in rock, paper, scissors, any human being would. But the point is, mathematically and based on game theory, if there's even a slight deviation in whether somebody's over bluffing or under bluffing or throwing rock too much or throwing rock not enough, the actual optimal solution for your given situation is to go 100% bluff catch or 100% fold. So that's why I would choose all of my hands to either call or all of my hands to fold, assuming they're in the range of like ace king to two pair. So based on this, I think I would probably lay it down. I don't know enough about how Rob plays. Maybe Doug has a little bit more insight. I've not seen him make any huge bluffs, and it's very hard to find these kind of bluffs to turn something like ace five or king 10 into a bluff in these kind of situations. He might not even have king 10 on the flop. He can very easily have something like eight, nine suited. King queen is kind of dicey to find in there, but it's possible, obviously. Ace jack, pocket 10s, pocket 7s, hands like this. I can find a lot of pretty easy value hands, and it's pretty hard to find bluffs. Also with the fact that recreational players tend not to bluff raise rivers very often at all, I'm gonna find the fold button here very likely, unless I pick up the wrong read. And let's see what Doug does.
I'll go to a few.
I call.
Oh, he does call. And he'll see the dreadful news.
Call for me.
Javier's.
I haven't heard that one yet.
Creative slow roll.
And a $487,000 pot heads Rob Young's way.
Vicious from Rob on the end, by the way. He said, good call for me.
Oh, yeah. A little needle on top.
That's right. He pays him off, and Rob Young gives him the old good call for me. Call an ambulance, but not for me. A little bit spicy there from Rob. I don't know if those guys know each other well enough, but you gotta respect the spice when he's on a live stream. Overall, this is a really fun stream, really fun hand. Let me know if there are any other hands that you think I should be breaking down from the more exploitative style. And if you're interested in learning to play poker like me and think about poker like me, head over to epiphanypoker.com. Link is in the description. It is such a wildly good community. People are in there every day talking strategy, helping each other out. But people between like play money, 2NL, and then people that are playing like 1,000, 2,000 NL. And I'm in there giving weekly coaching, actually more than weekly, because I just love hanging out and helping people learn and grow. It's such a positive community. It's such a powerful community. There are leaderboards, there's hand analysis, there's group sessions, there's affiliates if you want to get involved in that kind of stuff. It's really exciting, and we're only just starting. So the earlier you get in, the better. I'm sure you'll love it. Check out epiphanypoker.com. I wanted to sound not like an ad reel, but it is genuinely such a beautiful community. And if you could like the video and comment and share and all of these things, it is genuinely very helpful. I want to be growing this channel and reaching more people. So anyway, that's it from me. Beautiful people, I love you all. Peace.